Dear students, welcome to the next online session of Arvai Maruthuvam. And this video program is offered by Santhigiri News YouTube channel. I thank the organizers for providing this video program through which we are enriching our knowledge on Arvai Maruthuvam even during this lockdown period. Today we are going to discuss about the topic burns. It is included in a huge topic: burns, hemorrhage, mechanism of shock and types of shock. Usually this area is handled by the intensive care units of allopathic medical colleges, and this topic is included in our syllabus to sensitize the students of Siddha to make aware and to utilize the points in their own clinical practices. So as a first aid, it may require to deal these kind of cases in our clinical practice. So let us start the topic burns and its management. Let's start with definition. A burn is defined as an injury to the skin or other organic tissue primarily caused by heat, radiation, electricity, friction, or contact with chemicals. Heat burns due to hot liquids are called as scalds, and a heat burn due to hot solids are called as contact burns. The majority of these injuries occur in low and middle income countries. India has one of the highest incidence of burns in the world. Women and children are the victims about 80% of the time. Survival following burn injury has significantly improved over the last several years. Classification of burns is based on causative agent. Number one, thermal burns, injury due to heat. It can be classified as moist heat as scalds, and another one is dry heat or contact burn. Second one, electrical burns, injury due to passage of electricity. Third one, chemical burns, injury due to contact of chemicals. Four, cold or frostbite, injury due to exposure with extreme cold. Fifth, non-ionizing radiation, injury due to exposure with non-ionizing radiation such as ultraviolet rays or infrared rays. Clinically, burns are classified based on depth of burns. The first degree burns involves only the epidermis. Second degree burns involves varying thickness of dermis. It may be superficial dermal and deep dermal injuries. Third degree burn involves the full thickness of skin. It means they involves epidermis, dermis and subcutaneous tissue. Fourth degree burn, it involves skin, fascia, muscles or bones. The pathophysiology of burns, according to Jackson's description, the injury of burn wound consists of three zones. They are the zone of coagulation, zone of stasis, zone of hyperemia. The zone of coagulation is at the center of wound where no viable cells remain. Surrounding to it is the zone of stasis, characterized as a mix of viable and non-viable cells. This area represents the zone at risk due to the onset of capillary vasoconstriction and ischemia. This zone may undergo necrosis with hypoperfusion, desiccation, edema, and infarction. With proper wound care management and fluid resuscitation, however, these changes may be reversed. The periphery of the burn wound is the zone of hyperemia with viable cells and vasodilation, mediated by local inflammatory mediators. Tissue in this zone usually recovers completely unless complicated by infarction or severe hypoperfusion. Next, the burn shock. Thermal injury due to superficial vasodilation and hyperemia results in massive shift of fluid from vascular compartment to the interstitial compartment, thereby causing reduction in circulatory blood volume. It results with decreased venous return to the heart, thereby decreased cardiac output also. The insufficient delivery of oxygen and nutrients to tissues and removal of waste products from tissues causes shock. Another factor is burn injury releases several inflammatory mediators like histamine, prostaglandins, thromboxane, and kinins, and etc., which increases microvascular permeability and alter cell membrane functions. With these changes, before the treatment, we have to look for first aid. As a first aid, burns cases should be examined for airway, breathing, circulation, disability, and associated major injuries or complications. Airway, it means any evidence of choking in the airway, or it may be a foreign body, or any edema or froth, it should be found out and removed. Breathing, nature of breathing. If it is pathological type of breathing, oxygen supplementation is to be ensured at the earliest. Circulation, if any evidence of giddiness, imbalance, the patient should lie on orthostatic posture, the head low and leg raised position to facilitate blood flow to the brain. Disability like fractures should be immobilized with appropriate splints to prevent further complications. As a first aid, these things to be carefully examined and implemented at the earliest. In addition to that, as an emergency, when the patient is exposed to fire, first you have to put off flame by make the victim roll on the ground, or apply thick wet blanket on him, or using water or fire extinguisher to put off flame. Second, remove the source of injury. We have to avoid the continuation of exposure. Remove the items prolonging injury. Remove jewelry, belts, and other restrictive items. Cooling injured areas with running water. Gentle cleansing of affected area of dirt. As an emergency, these things should also be done. Next, coming to clinical evaluation. Clinical evaluation of burns patient is based on extent of burns and depth of burns. The extent of burns are estimated by Wallace rule of 9 to assess the total body surface area burnt. It delineates the body surface area into anatomical regions as multiples of 9 and genitalia as 1%. The extent of body surface area involved is one of the most important indicators of mortality, independent of the depth of injury. The depth of the burns is the main factor influencing the ability of the wound to heal itself, as the greater depth of injury will result in fewer surviving dermal and epidermal elements to initiate healing and regeneration. Thus, it is important in deciding on wound management and whether or not to intervene surgically. The depth of injury depends on the temperature of causative agent and the duration of the contact. The depth of injury is classified into 4 categories. For the first degree burns are superficial burns, involve only the epidermis. It forms erythema, edema, and burning sensation. It heals about 5 to 7 days. The second degree are partial thickness burns, involves the entirety of epidermis and a portion of dermis. Partial thickness burns are further divided into superficial and deep partial thickness based on the depth of dermal injury. Superficial partial thickness burns are typically pink, moist, and painful to touch. These burns will typically heal within 2 weeks and generally result in minimal scarring. Deep partial thickness burns involve the entirety of epidermis and extend to the reticular portion of dermis. These burns are typically dry and mottled pink and white in appearance and have variable sensation. If protected from infection, deep partial thickness burns will heal within 3 to 8 weeks. However, typically with scarring and possible contractures. However, if the wound is not completely re-epithelialized in 3 weeks of time, operative excision and grafting is recommended. Third degree are full thickness burns, involve the epidermis and entirety of dermis. These wounds are black, leathery, and they are usually insensible and do not blanch. Full thickness burns are best treated by excision and grafting. Infection remains resuscitation. There will be greater fluid loss by means of oozing of plasma fluid or blood and sweat due to exposure to heat. It should be corrected immediately, otherwise patient will be developed with hypovolemic shock. As a part of resuscitation, securing a good intravenous access is very important. For major burns, central venous line is preferred. Various formulae are used for calculating fluid requirement in burns. The commonly used are Parkland's formula. According to this formula, total fluid for first 24 hour is 4 ml into body weight in kilogram and percentage of total body surface area band. For example, 4 ml into as a human weighing 60 kilogram into 40% of burns is equal to 9,600 ml. Among this quantity, half of the calculated fluid given in the first
8 hours. The next half is to be given in next 16 hours. It is very important to maintain good urine output. It means 0.5 to 1 ml per kg per hour. It means the individual weighing 60 kg should have 30 to 60 ml of urine output per hour. Only crystalloids are used during first 24 hours. Fluid calculation should start from the time of burn and not from the time of arrival to the hospital. Adequacy of fluid resuscitation is assessed by monitoring pulse, blood pressure, and signs of dehydration. The better method is monitoring hourly urine output or central venous pressure. Care of burn wound. An ideal topical agent must be bactericidal, having broad spectrum coverage, non-toxic, easy to apply, should penetrate deep to SR, and should not cause any metabolic disturbance. But no such ideal agent is available so far. Commonly used agents are silver sulfadiazine, silver nitrate gel or solution, flucidic acid, and etc. Over the topical agent, cotton pads and bandaging is applied. Biological dressing gives temporary covering for the wound, alleviating pain and protection from infection. Examples for biological dressing are collagen and amniotic membrane. Nutritional support. Hypermetabolism occurs following the injury, and the diet should accommodate for the higher carbohydrate and protein requirements. This increased metabolic rate begins immediately following injury. This hypermetabolism occurs on the patient of burns. It may extend for months. Oral feeding should be encouraged. Those who does not tolerate oral feeds, nasogastric tube feeding may be given. Protein requirement can be calculated as 2 gram into kilogram of body weight per day. In addition to this, supplements such as vitamin C, vitamin A, zinc, omega-3 fatty acids, glutamine, iron, etc. are also to be given routinely. Complications. Early burn wound is sterile due to the thermal effect. Contamination of the wound occurs either from the environment or by opportunistic pathogens from the patient's own body. Infection remains a significant risk following burn injury. Burn patients are also immunocompromised for a number of reasons. One is loss of protective skin barrier. Two, cellular and humoral portions of immune response are compromised. Hypoproteinemia lead to decreased production of antibodies. 4. Impaired chemotaxis and phagocytosis. Thus, wound infection is the major complication. Further, shock, renal failure, septicemia, acute respiratory distress syndrome due to exposure to fumes or smoke, subsequently pneumonia, may also occur. Wound contracture may occur during normal wound healing. When there is excess of wound contraction, is an abnormal healing process leads to physical deformity and functional limitations. Electrical burns. Passage of electricity through the tissue generates heat, depending on tissue resistance. Low tension injuries are usually localized. High tension injuries can be devastating due to damage caused in depth than on surface. Patients with electrical burns can develop cardiac, renal, and neurological complications. In the extremities, can cause compartment syndrome, which will require early physiotherapy. Electrical burns may have associated injuries like fractures following fall secondary to electric shock. Higher urine output of 1 to 2 ml per kilogram body weight is necessary when associated with myoglobinuria. After hemodynamic stability, all devitalized tissues are deprived, which may need multiple stages and reconstruction with skin grafts or flaps. Chemical burns. Chemicals cause irritation and destruction of tissues by different chemical reactions when in direct contact. Severity of chemical burn is determined by concentration of the chemical, duration of contact with the tissues, quantity of the chemical, mechanism of action. Usually, chemicals may be acids or alkali. Alkali cause more damage due to liquefaction necrosis, whereas acids act by coagulation necrosis. Principles of management of chemical burns involve removal of all offending agents from the patient's body. The involved part is to be thoroughly washed under running tap water for half to 1 hour. When burn occurs with chemical powder, it should be dusted off first before irrigation. Friction burn. It occurs due to rubbing of skin against rough surface. Most common causes are road traffic accidents and sports injuries. Superficial injuries can be treated conservatively. Deeper wounds or full thickness wounds may require excision and skin grafting. Frostbite. It is due to exposure to cold wind or high altitude lesser than the freezing point of water. It is common in old age. Due to extreme cold exposure, damage to vessel wall occurs, which causes edema, blistering, and gangrene formation. Affected part is painless and waxy. The cells in the affected part get frozen at minus 5 degrees centigrade. Initially, there will be redness and edema, called as first degree. And on second degree, there will be blister formation. And on third degree, there will be skin necrosis. And on fourth degree, gangrene develops gradually. The treatment for frostbite is, the affected part should be wrapped with cotton wool and rested. Warming is gradually done with 44 degree centigrade in 30 minutes. With warm water. Advised to elevate the limbs to reduce edema. Intra-arterial vasodilators may help. Warm drinks, analgesics, and hyperbaric oxygen are also effective. If gangrene develops, amputation is needed. Non-ionizing radiation. This kind of radiation does not penetrate deep into tissues, but increases the risk of damage to skin and eyes. Depending on energy and exposure time, this can cause localized heating or photochemical reactions and may lead to possible permanent harm. The severity of injury can be assessed with assessing the extent and depth of injury, which are already discussed. Suitable examples for non-ionizing radiation are infrared and ultraviolet radiations.
And with these few words, I conclude my session, and I hope you are all being sensitized with these points of burns. And I request all of you to be thorough with first aid for burns. Definitely we will face such kind of cases in our day-to-day practices. Please refer the concerned textbooks and do keep the points thoroughly. Thank you. Once again, stay safe in your home. Thank you.